Hello viewers, watch the full video and please fill the assessment 3 by clicking the link in description. Finish the assessment 3 within 7th November 2020. For those who are not in our Telegram group, link is in description. E-certificates will be provided only on the completion of all the sessions assessments. Use the same email ID which you used in previous assessments. Happy Learning Team 2020.
In today's session, we'll discuss about aircraft navigation systems. A flight vehicle, regardless of whether it is a missile, an aircraft, or a launch vehicle, it needs the help of human intelligence in achieving its mission. This human intelligence manifests itself in various forms, like gathering information about flight conditions, generating appropriate commands to the flight vehicle, and designing equipment to interrupt these commands and translate them into action on board. Each flight vehicle has a mode of operation which might differ from one another. For example, if you take a missile or a launch vehicle, information is gathered by various sensors and conveyed to a computer, which then takes appropriate decisions. In the same way, if we consider an aircraft, it is usually the human pilot who takes decisions based upon similar information. Irrespective of the kind of vehicle, the theory behind the design and analysis of all these tasks eventually emanates from a branch of applied mathematics called control theory. The application of control theory to aerospace may be divided into four areas. They are flight planning, navigation, guidance, and control. What do you mean by flight planning? It is the determination of a nominal flight path and associated control histories for a given flight vehicle to accomplish specified objective with specified constraints. Navigation, the determination of strategy for estimating the position of a vehicle along the flight path given outputs from specified sensors. Third one is guidance, the determination of strategy for following the nominal path in presence of off-nominal conditions such as wind disturbances and navigation uncertainties. The last one is control, the determination of a strategy for maintaining the angular orientation of the vehicle during the flight, that is consistent with the guidance strategy and the vehicle, crew and passenger constraints. However, it should be kept in mind that these four categories often overlap and the boundaries between them are not very sharp. For example, consider the aircraft velocity and its angular orientation. They are coupled, and so guidance and control of the aircraft must be considered together. So we cannot separate navigation, guidance, or guidance and control. Four parameters are overlapped with each other. To navigate from one place to another place or to travel from one place to another place, pilot needs to know the following. He has to know the starting point, that is point of departure from where he has to start the aircraft, ending point, that is the final destination where he has to reach. Direction of travel, in which direction the pilot has to propel the aircraft to reach the destination. Distance of travel, what is the distance between point of departure and the final destination. Aircraft speed, aircraft fuel capacity, pilot has to ensure that sufficient fuel is present in the fuel tanks to reach the destination point. aircraft weight and balance information. These two plays an important role in maneuvering of an aircraft. With this information, the flight planning can commence and the proper method of navigation can be put to use. Aircraft navigation. Navigation may be considered as art of directing the movement of vehicle from one place to another place. This is like guiding an aircraft from one place to another place. It is an art practiced by all who travel, but its development is rooted firmly in the fundamentals of science. In today's context, it can be formally defined as the determination of strategy for estimating the position of a vehicle along the flight path, given output from the specified sensor. In earlier days, when man-made vehicles were surface-bound, either land or in the sea, they seldom ventured far beyond easily recognizable landmarks. The act of navigation could be carried out by humans using their senses to determine direction, distance, speed, and position. See, in earlier days, people used landmarks. If they want to travel from one place to another place, they used to use landmarks such as rivers, water bodies, or monuments or buildings. As vehicles became more and more sophisticated and their field of operation expanded to realms beyond the perception of limited human senses, sophisticated navigation system and instruments became necessary. Nowadays, the mode of transportation is air. Earlier, it was surface-bound or the sea-bound. I mean, people used to travel by bullock carts or ships, but most of us are traveling with the help of aircraft. So mode of operation has changed, mode of transportation has changed. So because of this advancement, we need sophisticated instruments. Instead of landmarks, these instruments uses information learned from the celestial bodies, certain distant object on the surface of the earth, and many other sources of information to carry out the job of navigation. Whenever a purposeful change in location has to take place for an aircraft, the following questions must be asked and answered by the pilot. For example, the flight has to take off from Bangalore, and if it has to reach Delhi, there is a flight plan which was developed, but suddenly due to weather conditions or due to some wind uncertainties, if the path has to change, then the pilot has to answer for these two questions. Where is the aircraft now? With corresponding to the flight plan, where is the aircraft now? Where is the aircraft now with respect to where it should have been? These two questions has to be answered with the help of a navigation system or with the aid of a navigation system. There are number of reasons why sophisticated systems have been become so important in modern times. They are time lag between the measurements and the decision need to be reduced. See, for example, if pilot has to take decision always, it is very difficult for him to measure the data and then calculate and finally to take the decision. But if we depend on the navigation systems or any method of navigation, the time lag between the measurement of the data and the decision will reduce. Number of aircraft in the given airspace has increased manifold in the past few decades. See, before 1990, the number of aircrafts were very less, but nowadays the number of aircrafts are increased. If you take any international airport, what happens? The frequency of aircraft has increased, right? One aircraft will be landing and another aircraft will be taking off. So the number of aircrafts had increased far beyond. Safety requirements have become crucial. Navigation systems or guidance systems plays an important role in terms of safety, because pilot has to know if there is any other airport in the same runway, aircraft in the same runway, or he has to know if there is any other aircraft entering into his airspace. What do you mean by airspace? It is an imaginary rectangular block around the aircraft. So individually, each aircraft will be having its own airspace. Along with the aircraft, the airspace will be moving. And pilot has to ensure that no other aircraft or spacecraft is entering his airspace. If it enters, it may lead to a crash or it may lead to an accident. A navigation system may provide information in a variety of forms appropriate to the need of an aircraft. If the information is primarily for the benefit of crew, it involves some type of display. Other inputs, however, may involve steering signals directly to the autopilot or digital information sent to central computer. However, in the modern context, one would consider these systems as navigation cum guidance systems. There are three different types of information that pilot can use. One is position information, display information, and steering commands. Before discussing about the actual methods of navigation used for aircraft, let us look into the main terminology of navigation. Course. Course is nothing but the direction in which the pilot wants the aircraft to propel or to move. It is also known as desired track. The second is heading. Heading refers to the actual direction towards which the aircraft is headed or towards which the nose of the aircraft is pointed, considering the effect of crosswinds. Bearing. It is the horizontal direction to the ground station or from the ground station. Nautical mile. Distance in aviation is measured in nautical miles. So usually if you are traveling through your bikes or automobiles, we will be measuring distance in terms of kilometers. In the same way, the distance in terms for aviation sector is measured in terms of nautical miles. One nautical mile is equal to 1.84 kilometers. Airspeed. It is an important parameter in aviation. It depends on the density of air and the temperature pressure. At any altitude greater than sea level, air will be less dense than sea level. For example, sea level, the density of air is 1.225 kg per meter cube. If you go for higher altitude, the value will change. So airspeed depends on the factors like density, temperature and pressure of air at a given altitude. What are the air navigation needs? When you want to model an navigation system or when you want to model an guidance system, there are certain parameters which you have to consider. Earth model as a reference. Have to consider Earth model as a reference system. A coordinate system to identify the position and to compute the distance. Third is navigation aid for reducing the workload of a navigator or pilot. We have to depend on the instruments, electronic instruments, to reduce the burden or to reduce the workload of a human pilot. Navigation requires the determination of position of aircraft and the direction in which the aircraft has to go to reach the destination. These are the four navigation needs. Then, basic navigation aids. Whatever the type of aircraft or the vehicle, we can rely upon two types of navigation aids, very basic navigation aids. They are aeronautical charts and magnetic compass. What are aeronautical charts? They are specialized maps that show more than geographic features. So other than geographic features, we can have some values of the atmosphere and all. Charts provides airways which are nothing but highways in the air. Location of airports, landmarks like mountains, rivers, lakes are provided in aeronautical charts. Magnetic compass. It is a well-known instrument or device. A compass is a navigational instrument that measures direction in the frame of reference, that is stationary relative to the surface of the earth. The frame of reference defines four directions or points. They are north, east, west, and south, along with intermediate directions. North corresponds to 0 degree and the angle increases in clockwise direction. So east is around 90 degree, south is 180 degree and west is 270 degree. Using magnetic compass, you can travel from one place to another place. How? Because we know that if the needle is pointing zero, then it is understood that we are facing the north direction. Methods of navigation. This is the important topic in the session 3. There are four methods of navigation which are currently in use. First one is navigation by pilates. Second one is celestial or astronomical navigation. Third one is dead reckoning. And fourth one is radio navigation. Navigation by pilates. In this particular method, the navigator or the pilot fixes the aircraft position on map by observing known visible landmarks. Visible landmarks can be river, mountains, islands, monuments or tall buildings. Then later he uses compass to find the direction to the next landmark or to the destination. It is one of the oldest means of navigation. Electronic pilates. Pilates is also possible with the aid of an airborne radar. This is called electronic pilates. The microwave search radar provide with a PPI, that is plan position display information, mapped to a terrain is used for electronic pilates. So basically we are mapping plan position and display information with the terrain. Terrain is the earth surface and we are depending on electronic or microwave search radar to reach the next location or the destination. The advantage of electronic pilates is the range is high, which is about 50 to 100 kilometers, and the accuracy is high compared to regular method of navigation by pilates. If the ground is visible, the navigator can use principal features on the ground such as rivers, coastal lines, estuaries, hills, and he can fix his position. Even during night times, light beacons provide information about the position of the aircraft. At the same time, we have disadvantages for electronic pilates method. Navigation by pilates is possible only under the conditions of good visibility. If the weather is bad, we cannot see the landmarks. Both the methods of pilates requires recognizable features on the terrain or on the surface of the earth. It cannot be used in large oceanographic regions because when the aircraft is flying over a ocean, if there is no island in the visibility range, it is difficult to navigate. Pilot is also depends upon the availability of accurate maps of the terrain. If you are traveling from one place to another place, you should have the map with respect to the point of departure and the point of destination. The map has to be with you. The pilot has to carry the map. The second method of navigation is celestial navigation. The name itself indicates that we are dealing with celestial bodies, or we are depending on celestial bodies for navigation purpose. I'm going to repeat the term navigation. Navigation is nothing but traveling from one place to another place. Navigator determines location of the aircraft by observing certain celestial bodies such as sun, moon and stars like North Star or Pole Star. A publication called Almanac, which lists the position of these celestial bodies at all times during the year. Every year the new almanac will be published. It measures the elevation of a celestial body by sextant. It is an instrument that measures the angular distance of a celestial body above the horizon, and it notes down the precise time at which the measurement is made with a chronometer. So the pilot has to carry all this information. He has to carry almanac, he has to carry sextant, he has to carry the chronometer. The two measurements are enough to fix the position of the aircraft on a circle of the face of the globe. So initially he has to find the position of the aircraft, and how he is going to find it? By using the almanac and by using the celestial body. And later, he has to measure the elevation of the celestial body with respect to horizon. By using these two parameters, he can fix his position on the map. Celestial navigation has an advantage that it is an independent system. We are not depending on any external aids. The disadvantage is visibility should be good to take the elevation angles of a celestial bodies. If visibility is poor, we cannot take the elevation or the angular distance of the celestial body with respect to horizon. To take this angular elevation, horizon has to be located. The third technique is dead reckoning. Navigator determines the aircraft position in relation to the last fix, which is a known position. Based on his previous position and the direction in which the pilot is traveling, or the speed at which the aircraft is traveling, by considering all these positions, we are going to fix the next position. Starting at the fix, or the first initial position, the navigator draws a line on the chart that represents the direction and the distance traveled. For this, velocity and time are the known variables. This is the most commonly used method of navigation. The same principle applied in the later advanced methods such as inertial navigation systems. The advantages of dead reckoning are: the position of an aircraft at any instant of time is calculated from the previously determined position. The speed of its motion with respect to Earth along the direction of its motion has to be considered. The disadvantage is navigation by dead reckoning over long distance is subjected to errors, unless intermediate checks are possible. If you are traveling from point A to point D, you have to perform intermediate checks at point B and C. You cannot directly travel to point D. Intermediate checks are required to get the accuracy. In this particular slide, we can see the picture which represents the effect of wind in the dead reckoning method. If you are having tailwind, tailwind is nothing but the direction of the wind will be same as the direction of the aircraft. It increases the velocity of the aircraft and it reduces the amount of drag. That is tailwind. Imagine a headwind. Headwind is both directions are opposite. Aircraft is moving from east to west. At the same time, wind is traveling from west to east. So, the velocity of the aircraft decreases and the drag increases because the aircraft has to resist this motion, right? Radio navigation, this is the fourth method of navigation. Using electromagnetic or radio waves to find the position of the aircraft. Transmitters located on the ground keep transmitting the radio signals to the aircraft. Airborne receivers, the receivers on the aircraft will receive the radio signals from one or more ground stations. And they determine the position, bearing, direction and distance. The disadvantages of radio navigation are, it requires transmitters and receivers. It is not a self-contained system. It is a dependent system. It is depending on transmitters, receivers to identify or to calculate its position. Aircraft is dependent on external systems. It requires line of sight communication. When you are in the line of sight with respect to transmitters or the ground station, then only you can get the radio signals. In this picture, we can see that interrogation is from ground and reply is from aircraft. It means we are using radio waves for communication purpose between the ground as well as the aircraft. Radio navigation systems or aircraft radio navigation systems can be classified into six types. They are ADF, which stands for Automatic Direction Finder, Very High Omnidirectional Range, which is famously known as VOR, then Distance Measuring Equipment, it is called as DME, Long Range Navigation, which is called as LORAN, TACN stands for Tactical Air Navigation Method, and Omega. Automatic Direction Finder. It is a radio navigation instrument. If tuned to a particular frequency of radio transmitter, it will point towards that transmitter. Its job is to point in the direction of whatever station you tune in. Usually ADF will be placed inside the cockpit. It is an aircraft instrument. The pilot can tune to a particular frequency. Based on this frequency, the needle or the pointer will show the direction towards the transmitter or towards the ground station. ADF system provides following navigational information. It provides relative bearing to or from the ground station, and it also identifies the station which transmits the signals. The ground transmitter, it is a non-directional beacon which transmits radio waves continuously. A directional antenna points to the beacon to receive the signal and enables the pilot to know the direction of the ground station. Relative bearing of the aircraft to ground station is indicated on the radio magnetic compass. The frequency is around 200 kHz to 3000 kHz. So when the needle is pointing towards that particular transmitter, it will be easy for the pilot to navigate for that particular point or to reach that particular airport. Disadvantage is it is reliable operation possible using ground stations up to few hundred miles. The next instrument or radio navigation system is very high omnidirectional range, which is called as VOR, bearing information to or from the ground station is provided by VOR. It also provides course deviation. If there is any deviation of the aircraft from its actual flight plan, immediately VOR will send the signal. Identification of the ground station is possible with the VOR, because each ground station has its own particular frequency which can be identified with the help of VOR. The frequency range is from 108 MHz to 117 MHz. Actually, it is generally plus or minus 1 degree of accuracy. Line of sight depends on the altitude of the aircraft. Typically, the range is about 212 nautical miles at an altitude of 30,000 feet and reduced to 1,000 feet. The third radio navigation system is DME, which is called as distance measuring instrument. DME provides distance from the station in nautical miles with very high degree of accuracy compared to other systems. Other radio navigation systems, DME provides, or DME gives, high accuracy. Frequency range is around 962 MHz to 1,213 MHz. In DME, airborne transmitter interrogates and ground station responds. I mean, if the pilot wants to tune into a particular ground station, he can tune in, or he can ask the ATC for providing the frequency. Then ground station will respond. Interrogation is in the form of paired pulses at a specific spacing are sent out from the aircraft and are received at ground stations. Reply from the ground station. In this picture, you can see the pulses, how the signal is transmitted. It is in the form of pulses P1 and P2. Stands for pulse 1 and pulse 2 respectively. DME. In DME, interrogation, I mean question, is from aircraft and reply is from ground station. So in this picture you can clearly observe this. This is a airport. We are having ground stations or the transmitters. You can see there are two aircrafts which are approaching towards landing. LORAN, it stands for long range navigation. It helps the plane. The plane has equipped for receiving special radio signals sent out continuously from transmitter stations. The signal will indicate the plane location. It is accurate system for long range navigation. If you want to travel for larger distances or long range, you can depend on LORAN. Based on the measurement of difference in time of arrival of the electromagnetic waves from one or more land based transmitters to the receiver of the aircraft. The next system is TACON. TACON stands for Tactical Air Navigation. It provides navigational information, both bearing as well as range information. Ground stations can be portable and set up at temporary airfields. This is the main advantage of when it comes to TACON navigation system. You can simply shift the ground station from one place to another place, and you can set up them temporarily. The next system is OMEGA. It was the first global radio navigation system which is designed for aircraft. It enables the aircraft to determine its position by receiving very low frequency radio signals transmitted by a network of fixed terrestrial radio beacons using a receiver unit. You can compare this with GPS. GPS we had space segment, right? Here the satellites are replaced by ground or terrestrial radio beacons. Continuously they will be transmitting signals, and the aircraft receivers or the receivers which are placed on the aircraft will receive this information. They will trilaterally the principle, or they will apply the triangulation principle to calculate the position of the aircraft. Inertial navigation system. It is a self-contained navigation system which consists of gyros, accelerometers, navigation computer. It provides the aircraft position and navigation information in response to the signals resulting from inertial efforts on the system components, and it does not require any information from external references. It is also a self-contained navigation system. The last one is satellite navigation system. GPS is the only system today which is able to show you exact position on the earth anytime, anywhere, and irrespective of the weather conditions. The system receiver on the aircraft will receive the signals from the satellites around the globe. Depending on the establishing of loci on which the aircraft is located, intersection of two or more loci establishes the position of the receiver. We already discussed about the GPS and other global navigation systems. We are depending on the satellites for the information. Then we will get the information from three or satellites for higher accuracy. When you trilaterate or when you draw a circles, when you draw the range of the each satellite, you will get a common intersection point. That common intersection point gives you the position of the aircraft. All the global navigation systems or satellite navigation systems comprises of three segments, that is user segment, space segment, and ground monitoring stations. So this is about aircraft navigation systems. I hope you enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.